Special meeting of the Enfield Town Council. Today is Wednesday, July 10th, 6 p.m. We're in council chambers, and may we start off with a roll call, please?
Councilman Arnone.
Here.
Councilman Bosco. Councilman Crowell.
Here.
Councilman Edgar. Councilman Hall. Mayor Copen.
Here.
Councilman Kinsler.
Here.
Councilman Lee.
Here.
Councilman Mangini.
Here.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Here.
Councilman Stokes.
Here.
We have 8 members present, 3 are absent.
Okay, the first item on our agenda is discussion on request of use of town-owned snow fence.
Included in your packet.
Wow, that's loud here.
Included in your packet. You think that's what it is? How's that? That's a little bit better. Included in your packet is a request from Trantolo and Trantolo representative there that is doing a fundraiser coming up, and they've requested to utilize our snow fence that we utilize for our special events. Apparently their company that was going to supply that had backed out, and they're in need of that type of snow fence. And again, I've included in the packet the request for your consideration. I don't have the authority to allow that, but if council would do a consensus that that would be allowed, we could let them use that then with all the possible, you know, liability insurance coverages for it.
No, Matt's asking for a consensus, either yes or no. And Norm LeBlanc, this is the Channel 3 Country Kids Camp. It's a benefit concert that they're holding up at Sun Valley on over the weekend. And he was at the 4th of July celebration and approached me. Actually, it was prior to. Got him in touch with Matt, and thus we have the opportunity to discuss it because of this special meeting. So, Cindy.
Thank you. I think it's an excellent idea, you know, to be able to offer or extend our, you know, product that they could use. The only concern or question that I have, and I'll direct it to Kevin through Scott, if I may, to protect our liability issues. I know we do have liability coverage. I want to be sure that that coverage would extend should anyone get hurt on this fence, should there be an issue involving the fence. I don't want any liability come back at Enfield because it is our fence. Are we going to be able to cover the basis there, Kevin?
Yeah, well, I understand that we'd be getting a certificate of insurance from the Channel 3 event camp.
Okay.
Folks naming us as an additional insured, and they've agreed if there's any damage to the fence that they'll repair would be responsible for replacing that too. So I don't see any problems.
Okay.
Legally.
Okay. Very good.
That.
Thank you.
Anyone, Tom?
Yep. Glad to help out. It's a great cause, and any little thing we can do is a good thing. Thanks.
Ken?
Who's putting the fence up and taking it down?
They would be responsible for all that. So actually, I think it may still be out here in our parking lot. They'd come pick it up and then bring it back when they're done.
This is right here on the town green?
Correct.
And what happens if they puncture us?
No. They'd be bringing it up to Stafford, to Sun Valley.
Oh, yeah. Okay. Yeah, it's not here, but the fencing is here right now. So they'd come pick it up, drive
it
over there.
So the event is not in town?
Correct.
Okay. That's all. Thank you.
Tom?
Yeah, I would approve it. The things that they do for us, and we're not using it this week. It would just be sitting there. I think it's a good idea. Thanks.
Anyone else? So, by a nod of heads, do we have consensus to do it? Yes, we do. Unanimous consent.
I will let him know
consensus.
Tomorrow.
Okay. Thank you. Next item, request a transfer of funds for fiscal year end 2012-13, $24,000. Resolved that in accordance with Chapter 6, Section 8F of the Town Charter, the following transfer is hereby made to DPW Water Pollution Control, construction-related services, $19,000, technical services, $5,000, from DPW Water Pollution Control Electricity, $24,000. Certified the funds are available. Lynn Nenny, Director of Finance.
So second.
By Deputy Mayor Nelson, seconded by Councilman Mangini. Discussion,
and this,
Matt?
This was an oversight on the larger one that was done at the last regular council meeting. So we're requesting that this be done to do a closeout for the year end.
We were sent the agenda link yesterday.
Aaron, I asked for a hard copy and I don't see it in here, but that's okay.
Okay. Would you like to read it?
No, you're good.
Okay. Anyone else? Sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Arnone?
Four.
Councilman Crowley?
Four.
Mayor Copen?
Four.
Councilman Kinsler?
Four.
Councilman Lee?
Four.
Councilman Mangini?
Four.
Deputy Mayor Nelson?
Four.
Councilman Stokes?
Four.
In favor, none against, no abstentions.
Next item, resolution setting a public hearing on amending the Enfield Town Code, Chapter 86, Utilities. Whereas the Enfield Town Council wishes to amend Chapter 86 Utilities to update necessary language and provide for charging of sewer fees based upon customers' usage. And whereas the council believes that this proposed amendment will create an equitable charge for use of the town's sewer system, as well as allow for sufficient revenues to provide for necessary upgrades and improvements to the water pollution control system. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Enfield Town Council does hereby schedule a public hearing to be held on August 5th, 2013 at 6:30 p.m. in the Enfield Town Hall, Council Chambers, 820 Enfield Street, Enfield, Connecticut, in order to allow interested citizens an opportunity to express their opinions regarding the amendment of the Enfield Town Code, Chapter 86, Utilities.
So moved.
By Councilman Mangini, seconded by Councilman Kinsler. Discussion?
First, let me apologize for taking that down while you were speaking.
Oh, that's all right.
But I realized it was going to make a loud noise right when it started, and I didn't want to make more noise, so I just let it go. Thank you very much. I wanted to go through a brief presentation on the changes that are going to be occurring as part of the sewer ordinance changes, as well as try to get more information regarding the actual fee structure. And just to let you know, we do have representatives from Woodard and Curran here tonight. So if we get into discussion or questions, I'll probably bring Jay up to help address those. This all began, actually, this began even before the council included in their goals this. What I'm going to be talking about, it started probably about 4 or 5 years ago. Council began discussing whether we should be, you know, making improvements, what type of improvements, how we're going to pay for it, should it be a user fee, shouldn't it be a user fee, stay the same or not. But as part of the 2011-13 council goals, one of the goals was to develop a user fee-based funding system for the Water Pollution Control Fund, as well as develop a capital improvement project for WPC, taking into account, you know, what the current streams are and what the necessary streams of revenue to achieve those improvements. So as part of that action plan, we engaged, after a RFP process, Woodard and Curran to conduct a user rate study, as well as develop that 10-year plan. And as council's aware, that 10-year plan identified over $35 million of necessary infrastructure improvements needed within our system to bring it up to current standards and meet the future needs of the town of Enfield. Then going the next step as part of the fiscal year 2014 budget, council approved the transition going from the ad valorem to the user fee-based system. And as you're aware, that you know, the first 6 months of this year is based upon ad valorem or the tax structure, while the second half, beginning January 1st, we switch over to a user fee-based system. And everything that we're going to be talking about going forward allows us to achieve that January 1st user fee system. One of the outcomes of the study, again, I know this is probably redundant for council, but for our audience, the study showed that to undertake those $35 million worth of improvement, as well as provide for the necessary funding for operations going forward, we're going to have a significant increase in the overall revenue stream. And effectively going from $3 million, which was in the 2013 budget, to over $5.7 million by 2020. And the whole debate I think council was having was, what is the most equitable way to pay for that increase? Was it to keep it within the tax structure, or was it to go to a user fee based? And in the end, after looking at different ways of going about getting those revenues, council decided to go with a two-tiered consumption-based model with a minimum bill. And although council's not going to be acting on this as part as council, but after this special meeting, we go into another special meeting, the WPCA will be then ultimately responsible for setting the rates. The way that that two-tiered structure with a minimum bill would work out is, for the first 5,000 gallons, a user would be charged a minimum fee of $50. And then for 5,000 to 20,000, which is the first tier, they would be charged $3.39 per thousand. And then if they use over 20,000, then those gallons would be charged at $5.08. Now, these numbers are a little bit different than what we had talked about during the budget process. I think they're actually a little bit less, if I'm not mistaken. But as we started calculating everything and redefining it, these were the numbers that ultimately worked out. So the amendments, and again, I'm trying to keep this all. This isn't the best picture. I've tried to keep it focused, because as you look through this, I'm sure you saw that there are considerable revisions to the existing code. But once you understand why there are so many, the rationale for them, I think it makes a lot more sense. So on those amendments, you know, the definitions, we haven't adjusted or updated this code in many, many years. And there's been a lot of change since 1967, as probably Councilman Arnone would be able to attest to. Not only in how water pollution, you know, is controlled going forward, but also in the state. So the definitions had to be updated to bring us, you know, in line with, you know, what's going on in current days. Septage haulers. And although that's actually not a septage hauler, that actually is how they used to clean sewers back in the day.
God, it's way.
This is this section has been updated as well and actually added to. Currently, we do accept septage, and septage is what comes, you know, when we're pumping out or somebody is getting their septic system pumped out and it's hauled to the plant by a hauler and we received it. That's septage. In the past, under the ad valorem, those individuals, you know, that cost would be taken care of because everybody was paying taxes for that, whether you fed into our sewer system or not. So there really wasn't any fee structure or user fee for that septage to be accepted at the WPCF. And so what's going to be happening, and again, the disposal fee part of it is going to be a part of what the WPCA will be talking about.
Matt, can I interrupt
yeah.
you? If council has a question,
yeah.
do you want them to hold questions, or do you want to field them now?
Field them as we go along, I think,
okay.
would be best.
And Bill has a question.
So on this slide, it discusses the hauler license, and I know
yes.
it's defined in the regs.
Yep.
But that's an annual
correct
license fee to
correct.
A hauler going from a business or a residence.
Yeah. So anybody that's doing business that's going to be delivering septage that we're going to accept, will have to annually file for a license with the town of Enfield.
And how does that, I'm sorry, if I could see the slide again, guys. How does that minimum fee, which I think was $60 for the first 1,000, how does that compare to the minimum fee that a resident would be paying if they were on the system? If the minimum
I'll ask Jay to come up for this one. Right.
Hi, so Jay Sheehan from Woodard and Curran for helping out the town on this. So I'm trying to understand your question.
Well, I think he's trying to draw a comparison to how the user fee structure would relate to this. And I think, you know, unfortunately, it's apples to oranges. So it's not, you can't say, well, you know, somebody that puts a minimum in on a quarter, that would be, you know, $50 for that minimum. So that would relate to this. I don't think you can make that comparison.
Okay.
So probably the best way to, I don't want to touch it. The best way to describe it is that now septic users are not paying a annual fee. In the past, they used to dispose of their septic. They'd call the hauler would come, they'd go to the WPCF and discharge all that waste and pay nothing. Now they would have a payment to make to the hauler. So the hauler would be charged this. It's expected that they would put it back on the septic users that they collect the septic from, and that's how it's equitable again.
So if, Tom, I'm gonna, if you don't mind, typical haul brought in for septic is what?
A couple thousand gallons, up to 4, depending on how big his truck is. But I might add that this, and I believe a lot of other towns already do this.
Absolutely.
Because again, you're coming in as a hauler, as a commercial business, and paying, well, I guess it was $5 at one time, but now it's nothing in that. And a lot of towns are still behind on this also. So it's a really more fair way of making sure that everyone gets some kind of charge to treat that waste. And that septic waste still is very difficult to treat. It's actually more difficult to treat than regular fresh waste, like we would say now. So it's tougher on the plant to have to treat that waste. So it's only fair that there's a rate structure for the septic hauler, because he's charging you the septic user for that anyway, because he has to do that in other towns. So his rate already to remove the septic from your waste, your tank, is already being paid for. He already takes that into consideration as a business.
And is the fee that we have set competitive with the?
That was my question.
Yep.
Yeah,
absolutely.
And I'm not sure how competitive.
It's right in line with Ellington, with, you know, the neighboring towns.
Okay, and nothing compels a hauler to use the Enfield facility in the regulations. It's strictly. Yep.
That's right. Now, one thing to kind of enhance what exactly Mr. Arnone said is that, you know, a septic tank in a home is not the $2,000 to $3,000. That's the truck. So a septic tank's probably 500 mm-hmm. to 1,000 gallons. Mm-hmm. So you're not paying even the whole $60. So hopefully the haulers don't, you know, I mean, they'll have to be reasonable because they're a competitive business. So they'll charge back, but it won't be $60. They'll have to decide for themselves what, you know, percentage they're going to do.
Okay, thank you.
Ken?
I'm all set, Scott.
Ken?
Will the wastewater treatment plant be open to other towns' waste now? I mean, if a particular hauler has 3/4 of a load from East Windsor and comes through Enfield, hits Carol's house, can he now dump that whole load in Enfield and pay the fee?
Yeah, that's how it's set up. Correct.
And I guess I heard we're comparable with other towns and stuff like that, but what I didn't hear is that $60 enough to treat 1,000 gallons? Because with a septic, you're right, you're treating more solid than you are liquid, where the average house is dumping the water and everything that goes with it. So we're giving them more of a... So for $60, are we able to treat 1,000 gallons of solid? Because what I'm getting at is I don't want to encourage them to bring sewage from other towns, because it's, you know, we're losing money in Enfield to get rid of it.
Absolutely.
I mean, if that was the case, I'd rather charge a little bit more and encourage them to go to another town. Right. You know, and I'm on a septic, so this is my fee I'm going to end up paying. But, I mean, in the whole event field, if it costs more than $60 to treat 1,000 gallons, I think we should charge more than $60 for 1,000 gallons. Yep. I would really like to know what that number is. And I know it's going to be tough to pinpoint it, but, you know, over trial and error through the landfill, I think we've come up with something. You know, people don't like the price, but that's what it costs us to get rid of the waste. So, I mean, I would hope the council keeps an eye on this over the next several years and adjust that rate accordingly so it doesn't cost us, you know, or cost the sewer user more money to pick up the tab for the people on the septic. You know, we've been paying a sewer fee all along without it, so I want to continue to pay my fair share, but make it fair. So,
yeah, we'll look at that and see if we can calculate that out before the next meeting.
Yep. We may or may not be able to now, because right now, because septic was free, it's really not measured. So it may be challenging, but it is a benchmarking time. So if this was adopted, for instance, as you said, we got to watch it over the next few years. We'll try to come up with something for now, but if we can't, then you still have, I mean, you're absolutely right. It's got to pay for the service.
Okay, thank you.
Tom?
Yeah, I'm not really comfortable with that. The other towns coming in, there's other towns have their own structures. Most every town in this area has their own place to discharge it.
Oh, sorry.
And, you know, when we get into the actual solids that are coming into this town from other towns, we don't know if it's going to be grease laden. We don't know what's going to come in from other towns. We don't know if it's from private property or from business. What I remember in this town as well as others, that a homeowner or commercial business would have to sign a receipt certificate from the hauler to bring it to our treatment plant, which that verified where the sewage was coming from, which I think is important, because then we're going to have people putting half a load in from Summers and half a load of this in and trying to get over here because it's easier place to dump, and it's very expensive, and I'd rather have it see it stay within to prove where it's coming from, just for the treatment facility's sake, because you don't know if it's coming from the sludge on the bottom of a car wash that'll wreck the process, something from an industrial waste that'll wreck the process. We really should keep a tight rein on that expression. And I don't want to over talk it tonight. Thank you.
Thanks, Tom. Tom?
Yeah, sort of to echo that. I think our town, our facility, their town, their facility. I don't know how farms play into this, you know, out there in the rural areas and other, you know, agricultural kind of, you know, we have a lot of that out there in the surrounding towns, and I just fear we have a low amount of septic in our town compared to the people that have full sewer, so I don't think the strain level, you know, I don't want to see 15 trucks a day showing up all of a sudden instead of what normally would might be two. I think that's going to make a big difference. So I if there's a way to do that with keeping it local for us, I would be in favor of that.
Ken?
I would have to disagree. Being in business, you know the cost that it's going to take for this truck to bring a quarter load to the Enfield dump, because his next load is in East Windsor. His load after that's in Summers. These guys have them all over the state. And, you know, who's to say the load didn't come out of one of Enfield's restaurants? Or you're never going to be able to monitor this. And as long as it's a break even or even a little profitable to run the sewer plant, what's it matter? I mean, I understand what you're saying, Tom, but these guys are running a business. And now if I have to pay for that truck to bring my sewerage only, you're adding another $100 onto that bill. That's ridiculous. And that doesn't come to the town. It has nothing to do with the process. So I would say as long as the price is cost neutral or a positive for the town, it really shouldn't matter where the waste came from.
Sure.
So I guess my question then would be, because I didn't really think about it the way Ken mentioned it, would today, do we know how many loads average a day we get at the plant, and
three a day, four a day,
and any idea on, you know, today they're all doing like Ken just said, and they're picking up a route, and then that route may include Enfield, may not include Enfield.
They should have a ticket.
Include a slip.
They gotta have.
But they do have a homeowner signed slip.
So today we're not taking out of town?
No.
Right.
But we don't get no discount either.
No.
All set?
Right.
Joey?
I'm on a fence on either side of this one. One, I really think if we could get a fee on what it costs us to treat it, and if we can do like we did with the transfer station, make a little bit on it, really who cares where it comes from, because we'll be in the positive. The only thing I'm worried about is if it costs us too much to treat the waste that comes out of the septic tank, I don't want Enfield residents paying for someone else's waste. So I think it's very important that we try to figure out what it costs us to process it. Because if it costs us less than $60 to process it, why not take it from someone else? It really depends on where that processing fee is. And, you know, we don't want to keep hitting the taxpayers of Enfield for someone else's stuff. But on the other hand, if we can do it at a reasonable price and make some money at it, that wouldn't be a bad thing either. So I think it's really important that we find out what that fee is that it costs us to process that waste. And then we can decide, do we just do it for other people or we do it just for Enfield residents? Because if we can go into the positive, what's the difference if the waste guy drops it here or somewhere else? Thank you.
Anyone else on this? Go ahead, Tom.
I hear what you're saying, but I'd like to hear from the wastewater treatment plant and how that facility is set up to handle this to begin with. Because, again, we can give it the influx, and we don't have the facility to treat it. If we had the facility to treat it in the future, and I'm all for if we can take other towns in. And don't get me wrong with the wastewater treatment plant. Our plant's large enough to take other towns in for sewerage, let alone just septic. I'm not against that, honestly, guys. I agree on bringing people in, make a little money on it, but we got to make sure our facility can handle it, and I'm not sure it can.
And that's my point. I wish I knew more about this crap. Yeah. Because if I knew more about it, then I could make an honest decision.
You're just trying to save all this crap. We're not set up.
Well, we can, for the next meeting, obviously, we'll look at that and present something to you to try to answer those questions to the best of our ability. Let me just say that you know, the hardest thing to predict is what we don't know. And we don't know what are the changes, you know, in allowing this. Because right now, the only waste that is supposed to be coming here is from Enfield residents. And so when you open it up, will that change behavior that much where, you know, where they're, you know, they're going to Windsor Locks now or just wherever, they're going to say, oh, let's go to Enfield instead. That may, you know, that may or may not occur. We just, it's kind of hard to predict that right now. And then it comes really down to pricing. You know, if we're at the same price as another, community's plant, but they can save on fuel because they're right here, you know, that may drive them differently than before. So, I mean, there's a number of different things that I think is going to be difficult to predict what impact will happen until it happens. But, go ahead.
Not to interrupt, but yeah. Grease is my issue. Yeah. And we'll take septic aside for the moment because it's a very small percentage of it. What the real issue in the industry is grease. If we're going to take commercial grease from restaurants, then you're going to see a big uptick if we take it from everyone's restaurants in every town, because that's where the money is. The money is in removal of grease from commercial businesses. And that is incredible to take care of. That's my question.
Yeah. And actually, that could, I think, is the next slide.
It's next slide.
So the change here, obviously, is that you know, we're going to be opening it up for anybody, any haulers, to deliver this waste and obviously charge a fee for that. Any other questions on septage? I didn't realize, you know, of all the different sections, this is the one that I thought, boy, you know, they're going to want me to change the page on this one.
I would just have one question about the grease. With all the biodiesel products and stuff like that out there right now and these companies buying waste oil off of restaurants, Are we seeing the grease problem drop? I would think if you could sell this commodity, why would you want to dispose of it in the sewer system? I mean, and I'm asking because you're throwing away money.
Oh, we're making jokes. I'm sorry.
Yeah.
They're not using it, though.
They're not. It's still a problem.
It's kind of a dirty grease.
Right. Right. There's really, if I may, there's really two different kinds of grease. There's the yellow grease, the Frylator stuff, which you can process very easily and basically put in your car as diesel. Then there's the dirty grease, which is more of the,
okay,
the byproduct.
Separates.
It goes to the grease trap.
Okay.
It's kind of made of,
okay,
hair, and it made of other things that,
okay,
aren't as good. So to get to something like what you're talking about with energy, it's really anaerobic digestion or some other processing that has to happen that the plant's not currently set up for.
Right. Okay. Thank you.
So this section we have right now, the fat, oil, and grease section, that's actually being changed to a special... Can't think off the top. Special, what did you call that?
Special wastes.
Special waste, I can't remember exactly. And so what this section and changes will do, one, brings us in compliance with the state statute. It establishes fees for disposal of the fats, oils, and greases, and requires a defined user to seek the permit from DEP. That's going to be hooking onto our system. So right now, I think actually the state statute requires that different levels of users, I want to say it's over 5,000 for a residential development, I think it's 25,000 for industrial users, they actually are supposed to be getting a permit through DEEP to be able to hook into our system, besides getting a permit from us to hook into that. So one of the biggest changes really is adding all that state statute within this section that you know allows for us to do the things the state says we're supposed to be doing. But even more so comes up to what I think you know Tom identified as well, which is we're now going to be charging for people to bring grease here, which could again change the behavior that it may come to us. Now, under the fee structure, they're looking, or what was put forward, is a, I think it's 30 cents per gallon accepted into the system. Other parts of this, and I had this conversation with Councilman Lee a little bit earlier, it also establishes a annual licensing for those companies that utilize the grease collection system. So we'd be going out and inspecting in some way, and whether we do it in-house or work possibly with the health department, I mean, that's still to be determined, but it would be a requirement for people to register those on an annual basis with us.
Joey?
If this stuff is so bad for us to try to process, do we have to take it? You know, and the reason why I say that is I have oil separator. I have to get a permit from the state for my oil separator. I have to pay a company to come in, and they vac it down. They clean my drains for the silt, and it's hauled away as whatever, hazardous or wherever they consider it, and they take it to a processing plant, and they clean it and then get it done. It doesn't go into the sanitary system at all. So if this is that bad, why don't we just tell these restaurants, I'm sorry, you're going to have to call a rendering company that comes and pumps this, and that's it. I mean, they do it to all the garages and anyone that has oil-water separators. If it's going to save our sewer plant, you know, I don't know enough about it, and that's why I'm asking.
I would ask Jay, I don't think there's any state requirement that we accept this type of waste at our plant.
No, you don't have to accept it. There's no requirement to do so.
What do we do today?
We take it in, we dispose of it at 18 cents a gallon plus labor charges. So it's probably costing us more than 30 cents a gallon.
Yeah, so we're not actually processing it. We dispose of it.
Off-site.
Right.
It goes off site, just as you suggested.
Yeah.
If you may, and if that's the case and we're going to take it, then we should be making 10 cents a gallon to handle it.
And that's how we've set it up. Yeah. So it's 18 cents to dispose of. We've set the price at 30, so 12 cents a gallon.
So we don't run that through our system. It's handled
correct,
more or less the same way I'm saying. It's just that we're going to make the thing that then what? How do we get it? How do they bring it to us? Or they?
You might as well come up to the mic. Just introduce yourself for the audience, if you would.
Kevin Schlatz, Water Pollution Control Superintendent. Currently, right now, it comes in via truck. They collect it from the restaurants, and we take it into a, we have a grease pit. And once a week, we suck out the grease pit and take it down the Meriden. We dispose of it. It costs us 18 cents a gallon just to dispose of it. Unfortunately, it takes about 5 man hours round trip to go from here to there and waiting. So I don't know the exact number, but we're looking at 20 to 30 plus cents a gallon just for us to get rid of it.
Well, then I think it should be more than that. I mean, the 30 cents is you know, right. You know, we should at least get what it would cost that guy that's pumping it. He doesn't want to drive to Meriden for 20 cents. So, you know, we should be charging more. So it's not worth it for him to come to dump it into our tank so we can suck it and bring it back. You know, that way he just takes it and it's gone. And that's why I just think we're better off not taking it, letting the hauler get rid of it.
Pat?
Could you pass me for
now? Sure. Tom?
How much of that would you say we take in on a daily basis average?
Probably 1 to 2 loads a week, so I figure about 2,000 to 3,000 gallons.
A week?
Yes.
From our, basically our local restaurants?
Yes.
And could we do that over at the transfer station instead of even getting the...
I don't think we're set up for that, the transfer station.
No, you're looking at doing a whole separate facility. There's actually regional facilities you can get rid of it at. There's 3 towns, plus there are some larger plants that do take it at a cheaper rate because they take it and burn it. So there are other disposal options.
And does Matt, through Scott to Matt, the Covanta doesn't have a something up in Agawam for grease?
Yeah, I don't think for that type of waste, but it was whispered to me. So.
From my prior experience, I served on the MDC for 6 or 8 years, and I think they take it in and burn it, or they were looking at it at one point to do that. So that's one of their major pieces that they have down in Hartford.
They only take it from their
member towns?
Yes.
Yeah, that's
of course. So then my last question would be, if we decided not to take it at all, what do you think the impact would be on the businesses? Would there be, other than the fact that they would have to drive an extra 40 minutes to get rid of it?
That would be the biggest change, is that they would probably have a higher disposal cost than what they currently have today. Okay. Just because of the transport and
they're going to have that anyway. So I guess my opinion is, all else being equal, would be to not take it.
All set?
Yeah.
Pat?
And because I really don't know a lot about this, the industrial grease traps, Joey, like you were talking about, that would be the stuff that we collect once a year on from households, that type of oil and grease, or are we just talking...
No, we don't.
Something different?
Yes.
So the stuff that would come out of like a garage, you're talking about your garage, something like a garage. Is that stuff we do accept now or don't accept?
We don't accept.
And we don't plan on accepting, correct?
No.
That's part of this, is we're not going to accept it.
He's got a different waste. His is
okay. I just wanted to make sure that stuff we're not bringing in.
Correct.
We're talking food.
Oh.
Food, grease, oil.
Yeah.
Ours has to be hauled
and
certified license.
Just want to be sure.
Greg?
I guess my only opinion on this is the two choices. Either, if we're going to do this, is that we cover our costs, maybe, you know, like Bill just mentioned to me, 110%, so we get some gain on this, or we don't accept it. So either we can have a new fee that covers the cost plus, and then the deliverers have the option what they want to do. But I think that we'd have to cover our cost on that. That's my opinion. So,
Tom?
So now we serve the, we actually serve our businesses by taking it now. We're taking it, we're hauling it. We don't have numbers on what that costs us just to do that, because if we're doing it now and we're taking in X amount of gallons and it takes X amount of time to actually haul it, and you're saying you got 4 man hours, so we should have some kind of yearly breakdown that we can actually, you know, get our arms around and get a better price. Because if we're doing it now and we have to take it again, it's, as you know, you know, it's hard to pump, it's hard to handle, it clogs, it's a difficult, that's why nobody wants to do it except the incinerators, and even they have a hard time with it, and I just again want to make sure that we're charging the proper amount of money, and it should be more than just the it should put in enough money to look forward to facility upgrades in that line other than a pit and a pump.
Go ahead, Pat.
Kevin, do we now take stuff in from the prison at all?
We do take their wastewater into the prison. Their grease stuff, I don't know what happens to it, so I couldn't honestly tell you where that goes, but we do take their wastewater.
We don't want
to. Not to be funny, but I just think that... How much do we take in from the prison now in wastewater, say, per month or any average?
Off the top of my head, I don't know. I know they're a good chunk of our flow.
Yeah, it's like 30%.
We do regulate it, though, right?
Yes, we do. We do bill them on a monthly basis.
Can we get those numbers?
Thank
you. Yep. Can we raise the cost on the prison?
It's, once the rate goes up, it will go up. Right now, they're paying a dollar.
They don't get a special rate or nothing.
No, they. When you set the rate, that's what they pay.
All right.
So, is the thought process to accept food, grease, oils, fats, to prevent it from going into the system in a legal way?
Well, obviously, the requirement is that any of those businesses that are required to have a grease trap has a functioning grease trap, and that's one of the reasons why we set up that annual inspection to make sure that we're actually they're doing what they're supposed to be doing. So, I think it was probably in most communities, you know, it's just an outlet for people, you know, especially for a tax-driven system, to provide that as a benefit for paying taxes to pay for it. But there shouldn't be any compliance issues if everybody does what they're supposed to do.
What they're supposed to do. And remind me again of the cost, the proposed cost versus, because we don't have data as to what it costs us today.
Oh.
But have, correct?
Right, right. That's,
but have we set a fee?
Yeah, that is 30 cents a thousand, or excuse me, 30 cents a gallon.
30 cents a gallon.
Yes.
And what does that cost at other facilities?
Now, I would have to go back to Jay if he would have those numbers.
I don't have them right now, but we can.
Depending on where you go, it's 24 to 25 cents a gallon.
To dispose, plus the transportation to get there.
Right. There's only one place that's less expensive, and they're an incinerator facility. They take it because they want it, and it's 10 cents a gallon.
Okay.
Going to Councilman Crowley's question, we take approximately, last month we took in 23,000 gallons from the prison. We do bill them at $1.33 a gallon. Their bill last month was approximately 31,000. But if they do go over a certain amount, it then goes up to $6 per 1,000 gallons.
I remember that. Cindy?
Now, I remember 2 years back, you had a problem collecting from the prison.
Sure. I can't hear you.
I'm sorry. I remember a few years back, we had a problem collecting from the prison, from the state, and there was a big to-do about that. So I'm guessing that we've corrected that situation, that we are now receiving the money that we're supposed to get.
Yeah.
So there's no
as
more.
As far as I know, we're receiving, I'll look to Lynn to make sure we're receiving our payments from them, right?
Payments on a regular basis.
Yeah. Okay. And that wasn't that they weren't paying us, it was that they weren't paying us for all the waste.
Right. So I just want to make sure we stay on top of that part,
yep,
too.
Oh, yeah. Oh, yeah. We watch that.
Okay. Thank you.
Ken?
Who's in charge of doing the yearly inspections?
For the grease traps?
Mm-hmm.
Well, that's what, you know, before we started, there was an internal conversation about that here. You know, the choice has come down to it would be one of our inspectors going out and doing that. And I don't think they do that now. They do it when they're installed, right? But we don't do any annual or periodic inspections.
Only if there's issues with the business. We do find those once in a while. But there really is no yearly inspection.
And so we would have to start that process up, or we could possibly partner and talk, have a discussion with the health department to do that. So, I mean, there's a couple different options we have.
Well, they're having issues doing their own regular inspections for the health. So I would say definitely not there. And I guess I misunderstood what you said, because I thought it was you were stating that we do it now.
No.
And my concern is we have problems at the square where we know grease is getting dumped into our sewer line and it keeps plugging up the sewer line, but yet nobody's made a move to either shut down the problem until it's corrected. Mm-hmm. You know, I mean, there's an issue there that needs to be addressed and nobody's addressing it. So, I mean, somebody's got to be in charge of doing this, and we're not doing it right now where we know we have problems. So, I mean, that's a big issue. We talk about charging them for the grease that's going in legally. We know of issues where it's going in illegally, and we're not doing anything. And that really needs to be addressed immediately.
Do we know who's doing that?
Yeah, we do know who's doing it. And I just don't want to mention any names. Yeah,
No, I understand.
We do catch some restaurants when we do our grease as we see it coming out of their lateral. We check on when we do see it, we do check to see when it was last pumped.
And they have all their certificates. I mean, well, we just went through all this. They have proof that they've been pumping their grease trap and everything. You pop the manhole, you can see the grease clear as day. So there's a problem there. But it seems to get dropped there until another restaurant backs up and their bathrooms overflow with sewage from a restaurant that's uphill from them, and we can't seem to solve the issue. So, I mean, nobody's patrolling this problem right now, and we need to start. You know, how many other restaurants are doing the same thing or not being inspected at all, where they're just dumping that dirty grease, as Tom calls it, in our sewer system? So I really hope we take a good look at that and we follow our inspection. I mean, more than just checking a receipt that they had their grease trap pumped. I mean, pop a manhole every so often and see if we're getting a grease issue and track it. I mean, it's not that hard to follow the grease uphill. That's all.
Next?
The edit.
Oh.
Did it? Okay.
Okay. Good, 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 good. Continue.
Another area that is being updated as part of the amendments is for connection fees. Based upon the proposed changes, we would be charging $3,000 per each separately sellable, rentable, and or transferable unit that gets connected to our system, and $2,000 for hotels, motels, and inns per individual unit.
Tom?
That's right on line with the industry. I'm glad to see that in here. I was going to ask, and also a great picture of the effluent water strainer. That's still there, huh?
Yes, you know, a lot of these pictures are some of the proposed upgrades.
That would be one of them, I would assume. No, that's good. I'm glad we put that in for hotels, especially because they're a huge water user and on the system, and those are fair prices.
When you say per individual unit under hotels, motels, inns, that's per room?
Correct.
And would you classify a restroom as a room?
No. I think it's only the would can be considered the rentable rooms, right?
So if the Holiday Inn has, I don't know, 200 rooms and say 20 different bathrooms,
right,
you know, public bathrooms or whatever.
Right.
It's
yeah,
for
no.
The 200 rooms.
Correct. And that is consistent with how, and I'm not sure in Connecticut, but I know in Ohio and New York, I mean, that's pretty standard how we did the charging.
That's new construction.
Correct.
Connection fees. Yeah.
New connections.
Got it. Okay. Joey?
What if someone does a subdivision, they're not charged for the lateral then coming in, it's just per unit that they're building?
Well, they would, for putting any of the infrastructure in the subdivision, they would be responsible
Correct.
For the cost of inserting or putting that infrastructure in. And so then it would become, when the house comes in for their permits, they would have to then pay the connection fee.
Okay.
And then one of the other areas that is changed is based upon the billing. And what is proposed is going to a quarterly billing process, quarter one, January, March, quarter two, April, for June, quarter three, July, September, and quarter four, October, December. One of the big questions that I know we've received, I'm sure you've had inquiries about, is how are we going to handle the summer months related to the use of sprinklers or filling the pool? And we've batted this around a number of different ways. Originally, we were looking at going just with 80% year-round of what the flow was, but I think that still wasn't a very clear understanding, or wasn't a clear understanding for the residents. And so in looking at it, what is being proposed is going to what is called here a summer adjustment. And so the quarter that takes in those heavily sprinklered time frames, which would be the third quarter, will be based upon an average usage in the preceding three quarters. So you'd look at the low flow months or the low flow quarters, take that average, and that would then be the basis for the bill for that third quarter.
Tom?
I like it. The only issue is it seems to me that June is a big, big, and May, a big pool filling month and somewhat of a watering. Like this past June, mm-hmm. We certainly had the temperature for it. We didn't need to do much watering. We had some of that naturally. But, some watering happens in June, and it's definitely a higher month of water usage. If you add pools in, that kind of – I think everybody in town that owns a pool is going to – say that's not fair. Originally we had talked about some other towns in looking at the way they did it, and I had seemed to remember hearing January, February, March,
right,
using times that. Four, then you avoid all that. Why wouldn't we want to do that here?
What I can speak to that a little bit is that we did look at we have a model, and the model has to get to $35 million plus, for the next, 10 years or so. We can slice it however needs to be done. So when we went back to do a summer adjustment, we looked at exactly that. We looked at just using the winter months, and it was so sporadic. There's a bunch of people that fly south for the winter. There were a lot of minimums in that month. It just became very...
What if you did October through March? And did those 6 months? Not many people, I don't think anybody's watering their lawn in October. And they're not filling their pools in October, and they're not filling them before March.
Right. I mean,
would that help?
It could be. I mean, we could do it any.
You just can't. I mean, I just don't think you can include June, and maybe not even May.
Well, and the issue there is with the filling of the pools. I mean, less sprinkling, because generally, the average April and May tends to be wetter, so there's less yard watering going on. And I think, again, that's what we're trying to capture, really, is the highest, the peak usage, where, again, April, May is still, it's starting to go up, but it's not at the peak. July generally is.
And no, I don't disagree with that.
That outweighs, I mean, when you look at that quarter, and understand, we're also trying to make this as simple as possible for people to understand, so there's a good transparency.
I would be an advocate of October through March. That takes into consideration pools, watering, the two major things. But don't discount pools, because on any given street in Enfield, if you have 30 houses on that street, you're going to have 15 pools.
So just so I'm clear, so you're saying instead of just looking at...
Instead of looking at three quarters,
just look at two.
Just look at two. Half a year is a low use, and then maybe that'll help your little bumps you were talking about in the winter, for the snowbirds and folks who are just using a trickle of water, they're probably using some water in October and November and December.
Okay.
Just, I mean, that's what I would recommend.
Joey?
Well, using what you're saying, I would say, you know, the more months we have, the more stable it's going to be to try to come up with a number that's going to work. By September, you're pretty much done. So I would say September to the end of May, because most people aren't doing much in May either. You may get, you know, no matter what you do, you're going to have the people that say they fill their pool in their house on December. It's not, they're not going to think it's fair. But if you took out June, July, and August, them are the three heavy months that you're going to water your lawn, fill your pool, and do that. And you know something? Maybe you open your pool a week early and fill it up in May instead of June. You know, if they're that worried about spending or saving that little bit of water, but it's going to be a lot easier the more months we have to do this fairly. So the people that don't have pools and don't have sprinklers are not going to be paying that much more, because, you know, if you start cutting the amount of revenue coming in, it's going to have to go up.
Yeah, and that I think what we have to always remember about user fees, you know, we're trying to equitably spread the cost over, but understand in the end, you know, we have to generate somewhere between, you know, $5.2-5.7 million. And so if you're lowering it in one area, it just means that this area is going to go up to compensate for that. And I think, again, when you look at the April to June, you know, you have a relatively low flow month in April, a relatively, you know, higher flow month in June. They really kind of cancel each other out with that average, I think. So, we can do this however you want, but in the end, we're still going to be generating somewhere between $5.2-5.7 million.
And that's my point. If we do too much, the people that don't have pools are going to be paying for the people with pools.
Right.
And the people that don't have sprinklers are going to be paying for the people with sprinklers.
Exactly.
So, you know, you want to be fair with everybody, but you also got to be fair on the revenue coming in so everybody else isn't paying for other right. people.
Ken.
When you close a pool for the winter, you drain the water below your skimmer and you leave it. Right. You fill up the next 6-8 inches in the spring if you don't have to drain the water from all the winter's ice and snow, which most people end up having to drain the pool down a little bit. So people don't fill their pool from zero every year. So we're talking about a minimal amount for pools. And along with Joey and what Matt said, and I was going to say it, is if you cut one area, you got to raise it in another, because we need to hit a certain dollar amount. So, I mean, we're trying to do the best we can with sprinklers, and that varies. This winter or this summer, I haven't even turned mine on yet because it's rained right. so much. Yep. You know, so I'd be getting a great discount, but all the other people who don't have sprinklers would pay for it. So, I agree. It's very hard to try to determine an exact science to this. I agree with just that one adjustment you guys have in it, and, you know, simplify it so it's easier to explain, because yep. you guys are going to get the phone calls,
yep.
not us. Thank you.
Tom.
So if we were going to go into another quarter like June, if we wanted to pull June out of it one more month because of we, you know, water sprinkler systems, is that a problem because we're taking the billing from the water company? We're using their quarters. Obviously, these are the same quarters that you get for your water bill. Then we take that information and we turn it around and use it for our billing purposes. No. Can you do that? Can you pull out a month of the June if we wanted to, 1 month, and still be able to not disrupt billing?
Sorry, I was distracted.
That was a distraction. I agree.
So, yeah, I mean, it's math. It's pretty much math.
And that would be my concern is June.
And to play it forward in terms of implementation, you know, the idea is that we're going to have an outside vendor do the billing. So they'll, when we write the spec, it's got to look a little different. You know, so it'll change according to how we write the spec, but it's implementation. It's all math.
Yeah, and I also like to apologize to my wife. I gave her the one quarter that we were talking about earlier, and a few other people I've already told that to. And again, I apologize to any constituents that I had said that we were going to, we were looking at that one quarter average, and now it's I got to backpedal on it.
Yeah, we definitely looked at it. I mean, this has been probably one of the more active things that Witter and Curran had to do, because it just it's a very significant issue. I mean, not only from the perception side, but the way that it impacts what the actual rates are.
I think Mr. Bosco said it. You know, we used a 3-month just because it levels the disparity between the different, you know, the different months and quarters, and you know, so it's a bigger sample size, so that just levels things out. But it can be done anyway.
Yeah, and I just like to say that 1 month is a water lawn sprinkling water month, and I agree though with Joe and Ken that we got to keep the months in there. We do have to have a lot of months, but those ones you're going to get a lot of complaints in June of people saying, "Hey, I'm full blast watering my lawn in June." If you can do that, see, that's what I was problem was the quarters. If you can get rid of September and pull in June, that would be fair. I think a lot more easier to swallow.
Well, if they build that way,
how? Right. That was going to be my question: is how, like, when is the bill due? And you're doing the calculation over what month, and then the bill is due when? So, as an example, January, February, March.
Yep.
Gets billed when?
It's going to be billed probably April 1st.
Yeah, the reading, so we're at the discretion of the water companies. So if you think about it, they're going to go out and read their meters or electronically read them, however they do it. So January, February, March, their March 31st reading will probably be around April 15th. So it's a little later.
Yeah.
You're 1 month off. So we'll probably get the data April 15th. Billing company gets the data. They generate the bills, and so, you know, shortly after that, end of April, the bill will go out.
And then from a financial perspective, when do you want to start receiving the cash?
January 1st.
Because at least in my line of work, I find that you wind up taking data from 3 months. So as an example, January, February, March data would then be payable May 1.
Right.
Because you give a month to collect the data, create the invoices, and send them out with an anticipated pay date of May 1.
Right.
So could you finagle the quarters? So you say, okay, when do you want to receive cash? You're probably going to want to receive cash the first of the fiscal month, and then so July 1,
mm-hmm.
3 months, but go back a month and use the calculation of 3. That might get you off of that, may get you into that June, July, August, right? Because it's July, October, January.
Mm-hmm.
What's that?
That's it right there. Right?
Well, you want the bill on that. You want people paying you on October, mm-hmm. but you're not going to collect data from July and September and be billed for October 1. What you would be doing is June, July, and August
right.
for October 1. So that takes that summer adjustment, and it moves it back a month, so it gives you your 3 summer months in a calculation period. Now, the question is, can the water company change their quarters to match when?
Well, and that's I think, you know, rather than thinking from the billing piece, I mean, I know it's under this, but what it's saying is that, you know, the first bill that you're going to get is going to be based upon that quarter, that first quarter. So whenever you receive the bill, it's based upon those first 3 months. So again, I think it would be difficult to ask the water companies to change their meter reading for this.
I know Hazardville Water has it spread throughout. I think they do a third, a third, a third over their within the, they got rolling quarters.
It's rolling, yeah.
So
are we going to be billing on a rolling basis?
Right. It's not like everyone has to pay Hazeville Water on January, April, July, and October. Because we actually just got a statement or a letter from them last month or whatever saying we're changing our billing cycles so that they receive a consistent flow of cash and they're handling their residents, you know, quarterly, but it's rolling. So they're handling a third mm-hmm. over that 3-month period.
Right.
So something to think about.
Yeah.
All right, I interrupted.
We'll definitely have that conversation.
I interrupted. Bill was next, and then Greg, and then Joey.
I think what you just said got to where I was going. And, I mean, we're saying in this slide we're showing quarters, but I'm wondering if we're going to be adopting just whatever the water utilities billing cycle is, and then my follow-up to the based on that, will our vendor be processing on that rolling basis as well? Is that something we've thought about?
You know, we had, for this exercise, we had always thought quarterly, but again, we're going to spec it, and they're going to do what the spec says. So it's flexible. It's the same.
Well, it's not flexible because we're putting it in an ordinance. So
right.
I mean, I think that's something we need. Yeah. Between now and when August. Council considers it, yeah, we'll have to get that beat down.
All right. No. Thank you.
Greg?
Yeah. A little bit off the subject, but it's dealing with billing. And Matt, you and I have talked about it. We have some businesses, I know one in particular, that they have their water supply, but it's used in their processing, which either is evaporated through their processing or it is trucked out afterwards, because once it's used in their processing, it needs to be trucked out according to regulations. And so I just wanted to put that on the radar that companies that take in water but use it for processing and stuff that need to do something to make sure that their bills are proportioned to what they're actually putting through the sewage. Because I think the estimate was 50,000 gallons in a short period of time. If that was the case, they'd be in a higher figure. But that's all either evaporated through their processing or trucked out afterwards. So,
do you know how, Jay, how that's handled in other communities? Because, I mean, that can't be unique to us.
No, it's not. I mean, there's the exceptions are always a little bit challenging. There's a couple ways to do it. One, you could have them meter their sewer. So they could install a meter at their expense, and then that could be backed out of their sewer bills. That's usually the way it's handled, yeah. But there's other ways as well that could be accommodated.
Is there a way then we can, for a business, and there may be a number here that have similar situations, that between now and the time this all starts, that they could be advised on, you know, early enough to make sure they don't want to see them hit January, then all of a sudden they get the first bill and then somebody says, oh, you needed to put a meter on that. Can we make sure that we're doing something to reach out to our industries that use, like I said, to make sure in advance they're able to adjust what they need to adjust? I think that'd be important. We don't want to have those phone calls that come in May or June or whatever we decide. So, all set.
Matt, a couple quick questions. Under the sewer connection fees, it talks about for residential, commercial, industrial connection fees. It does say new construction, but then right after it says renovation work on a unit basis. So just a clarification for maybe my own information. When you're talking about renovation work, on a residential home for connection purposes, we've already paid the town sewer liens. So what connection fee are we talking about there?
Great question. The intent of that is supposed to be, if it's being renovated, to add bedrooms or add more disposal capacity. So that maybe that needs to be better defined, but that the intent is new construction additions, changes in use.
Okay, so what you're saying that if somebody has a two-bedroom Cape that's finished downstairs, they don't have the upstairs finished, we're going to charge them an additional fee to finish their upstairs? Is that what you're proposing?
That's the... Yes.
Yes, yeah. It is the way it's written.
That's the way
yes.
it's written.
Yeah, it
so
is.
So that's a good, it's a great point.
Buddy. Yeah, that's, I have an issue with that. And then the other question I have is, what on the page where it says other fees on the back, it says meter reading charge $50 per reading quarterly on a non-water company meters. Can you tell me what you're describing there?
Sure, that's the, if in the event that there's do you do that now?
We currently do that now with a couple of users that are on wells. They're actually businesses. We actually go and read their meter and get a water meter usage reading, and that's how we bill them.
So these are strictly companies that have well but are connected to our sewers?
Correct.
Okay.
This one business is actually in another town, but they are connected to our sewer.
Gotcha.
So we go and read their meter.
Okay. All right. So I guess my only issue is on that front page in reference to that. I think that needs to be struck on the renovation work, but that's my personal feeling. That's it.
So based on that would be $3,000. Like when I did renovate it and built the upstairs and I added a bathroom, I'd be charged $3,000 to add a bathroom.
Right.
Why would you?
That's crazy.
Yeah, that's crazy.
She wants it struck.
Yeah, that doesn't make sense. That's what. That's the way this reads, though.
It shouldn't.
So why wouldn't?
Right.
Right.
Good point.
Yeah.
Thank
okay.
You.
I had Tom, then Bill.
No, who'd you Joey didn't. Go, Joey's next.
No, he. Okay.
It's your turn.
Hold rank and said she was
two,
next.
Oh, I thought I was.
See, I'm not sure she.
To.
Did.
I'm actually
glad you were first. Yeah. To Carol's excellent point, can we, through Scott to the town manager, can we look at maybe putting a percentage? You know, for instance, somebody has a 3-bedroom house and they are now going to pay a connection fee of $3,000 if it's new. If they renovate it and add 20% more bedrooms, we should only be charging 20% more than that original fee. If I have a 3-room house and I put a 1-bedroom thing on it, now I'm going to be paying, you know, 5 years after I build it, I'm going to be paying $6,000 under this. I should be paying the original 3 and, you know, a proportion to the size of the home above that.
Why?
As opposed to I start off with a 6-bedroom house and I go to a 7-bedroom house. You know what I'm saying?
It's a user fee. The more users, the bigger the fee.
No, I understand that, but I don't want to pay $3,000 twice.
You're not paying it at all.
If I renovate my house.
No, you're striking it. It's gone.
Oh, eliminate.
Yeah.
Okay. Then I'm good.
Bill, then Joe.
Yeah, because Bill will answer a lot of the questions.
Can I snag one of these?
If I always understood unit to be building unit. So for an example, if you took a 2-family and made it into a 3-family, you'd be adding a new water service to that unit. That would be subject.
And I think that's how, I mean, I wanted to go offline and discuss that with them to make sure before I said it, because I know once we say it, it's kind of out there. But I think that's what it really is talking about, is when you're adding units, not if you have a single family and you go from a 2-bedroom to 3-bedroom,
right.
It's not that. It's you have a single family and now you convert it into a 2-family.
Correct.
Then that would trigger the $3,000.
Right, so
because you're creating 2 units at that, or okay. You're creating an additional unit that was never there.
All right, so you'll be able to clarify that.
Yeah, and as that comes up, it's not defined in the definition, so we'd have to adjust that as well.
Okay. I know housing unit we've got defined somewhere else.
Right, and that's what I thought that language meant. Wasn't
next sentence down says exactly that.
So if you strike the word Carawan stricken, the next sentence down covers exactly what you just said. Any saleable unit, period.
So even an in-law apartment on the back of my Star Cape, not subject,
not
my, my water meter, not transferable separately, not deeded.
Right.
Okay. All right.
Right.
And then if I could, if I, maybe tell me if this is elsewhere in the document, but if I have septic now, and I have sewer available on my street that I have not connected to, what am I subject to in terms of fees? And I've been a resident for some time. So you're connecting to the sewer, you would have a sewer connection fee, and then you'd be subject to the annual fee. Plus, there's a cost of connection assessment that you would pay the connection charge as well. So if I've been paying the special assessment,
I think we have to clarify that because, again, that wasn't my understanding, and that was, again, one of the things, because I think, you know, the argument would be for somebody that has, you know, owned a home that's been paying the taxes for that they would say, I've already paid for that, and now you're, so I think
that's the big one hanging out there, I think. And
right.
Probably not too many folks left subject to that, but.
And I think it's there, but it needs to be clearer with that. Because, again, it's talking about new construction where, you know, a home that's been there for 50 years is not new construction.
Right.
But I think we need to clarify that maybe within the code itself to correct that. Not in the, I mean, there may be some language change to the sewer fee schedule to reflect that as well, but it's more important that we do it within the section of the code. So I have that down.
And it might be something that won't be available forever. I presume.
Well, I think, again, you kind of have to draw a date certain from when we switch from the ad valorem to the user fee. So, you know, a house that is built, you know, let's say January 2nd of 2014, so they wouldn't have had paid any of the taxes on that.
Right.
And so if they have a septic system at that point, and 5 years down the road they decide they want to hook in, I think the language should reflect that they would have to pay that $3,000 because their new construction after the ad valorem. And again, that's what I think this contemplates, and we just have to make sure the language is reflective of that.
Okay. Thank you.
But the intent is not for somebody that you know has owned a home that's been paying the ad valorem for, you know, since 1967,
right,
that they would have to pay that new connection fee.
Okay.
Because, again, it's anticipated just new construction would be paying that.
Okay. Excellent. Thank you.
Joey?
With the quarters, I guess really it doesn't matter which quarters and how they bill. If we start taking their information, say now or once we get it, we could, if we do October, November, December, and then do January, February, March, we have an average of 2 months there that we could come up with a number. So
two cycles.
Right. And then at that point there, you discount June, July, August, and then September, October, November, you're going to make up the difference for the other one. So if we start looking at their bills earlier, we can actually get an average, so we don't need to worry about it. And once we get past the first year, then we have all the information. It doesn't matter which months we don't count at that point. It's just going to be the toughest one is going to be that first billing cycle. So we really should start collecting information the billing cycle before, so we can come up with some kind of numbers that are relatively correct. And I think that's the fairest way to start this. Then after that, we'll have all the information. It doesn't matter which months you remove. And I'm looking here, private wells. Well user will be charged a quarterly basis on the average residential consumption. Now, what I'm worried about is farms. So they'll be just, they're just going to be build whatever we come up with for
the average residential.
The average residential. So if it's $250 a year, then that's no matter how much water they use or don't use, that's how much it's going to be.
Yeah, and they actually.
And I missed the beginning because I came in late. No, that's so.
Fine. This slide here actually includes that language. Actually, I took it directly from their information that was prepared for the fee schedule. And they're estimating that right now that average is about 16,000 gallons per quarter. So that's what they would be, build upon. Now, obviously, as those average quarters or those average users change those numbers, that will change.
But right
now, they're estimating it at 16,000 gallons.
So it doesn't matter if they use 1,000 gallons or 30,000 gallons. It's going to be based on...
Yeah, because unless we go out and put a meter on, which
right,
would not
and I don't
be very cost
that.
Effective for us.
Okay, good.
So that annual figure will be something that's adopted by the authority annually? Or it'll be a rolling figure.
It's a rolling. It's a rolling because adopting it in the
okay. So it'll be live as current as that billing cycle. Okay,
that's right. Correct.
That's great.
Joey, all set?
Yeah, all set.
Tom.
I'm gonna pass.
Okay.
It was answered.
Greg.
Going back to the fat soils in Greece, is there. Ordinance, I'm sure there is, but just want to cover the bases for those that are trying to dump it down the normal sewers and stuff. Is there fines and stuff that are out there and stuff that if somebody is not handling it properly, and how is that enforced? I think Kenny brought that up, but my thought is just want to make sure that the other side of it is being covered where if somebody's dumping in the wrong place. So I'd like to kind of see what that fine structure and how that procedures work to actually investigate somebody doing that. So
that's a good question.
Ken?
Along with Councilman Stokes, I'd be concerned about the fine part of it because sometimes the repair is a lot more costly than paying a fine. So I would say that you have a time limit. You repair it or you shut down. Because the thing with the sewer system is what you do in your own establishment doesn't only affect you. Somebody downline lower than you could be being flooded out by what you're doing. And this is happening. So, they're not losing any money in their establishment for what they're doing, but they're forcing other establishments to close their door, such as Easter, because their facilities are coming out of the toilet, the sewerage, it's not good.
But also puts wear and tear and damages in our facilities, too.
Absolutely.
So we're going to pay for this if it isn't done right. Right.
Along with a fine, I would also say you have a time limit where you are shut down.
I agree
so
with that.
So it doesn't continue to happen.
Anyone else? I've got a question. On the sewer connection fee, the $3,000 per each separately saleable, rentable, and or transferable unit. How does that $3,000 compare to the fees in surrounding municipalities? Someone asked a question earlier on a different fee, and they said that was comparable to what Ellington, East Windsor, Summer, Suffield charged. How's that three?
I'm going to defer to the person that looked at all those.
Yep, it's that could be. I'm not trying to be wishy-washy in the answer. It varies widely from town to town. So, for instance, Canton, Connecticut, I believe the number is $8,600 for that connection. This is three. Some are two. Some are less. Some are So it's. I think the best way to say it, it's on the lower side of average.
The lower side than average.
Yeah.
And what's the justification of, because a lot of our conversation has been recoup our costs, charge a fee that recoups the cost. Now this, there may not be any real costs associated with this. I would assume that there is because there's inspection, there's time for personnel. So is three the right number? Or is that a, throw a darn at a number because everyone ranges from $1,000 plus to $8,000, $9,000.
Right.
and where should Enfield be? What is our expense, you know, for that sewer connection fee? What are we, as a municipality, what are we expending to allow that to happen?
Right. Well, there's historically, you know, connection fees are designed not just to recoup the cost that we would, you know, on inspection for new connections, but, you know, some places you may see that instead of a connection fee, a capacity fee, because the thought process is that when the facility was built, it was built with a certain capacity, and it took into account, you know, what the community had online or what they thought was going to be online. And so the thinking goes that, you know, with every new connection, that's trying to repay the system for capacity and also build, you know, additional funds for additional capacity when you have to do the expansion, you know, in the future. Now, most communities never put that money aside where they say that is, I mean, where it should go, which is into some type of fund to prepare for the next expansion. But I mean, that has historically been the rationale for the connection fees or the capacity fees, depending upon where you're at. So they're designed not necessarily just to cover what your immediate costs are for that connection, but also to either repay or pay forward for the next capacity increase that has to happen.
So are we doing that at 3,000? If we're lower than average,
right?
You know, should it be 4? Should it? Where are we? When do we get to the point that we're actually doing what you just said?
Yeah, and I think that's where, when you look at other municipalities, you know, when you start saying what is that number, you know, as we try to keep, you know, the costs competitive from the development perspective, because that is what you'll start hearing, because, you know, people say, oh, you know, I go to wherever and they only charge me $1,500, so I'm never developing in Enfield again. So, I mean, there's also that component to it where you don't want to be, you know, at the top end of that cost. I mean, it really is, you know, I look at it more as throwing a dart at a board than actually trying to come up with, you know, the actual reflection, because, you know, again, depending upon what that next capacity increase is going to cost you, it's probably going to far exceed what you're collecting on that connection fee.
But, and capacity too would include pump stations, because when you look at Enfield, yeah, really where you could actually pay, build new residential, you're really talking.
Yeah, or areas where gravity isn't going to be an ally to us.
So I would say come back and look at that number and see if it's the right number, understanding where new home construction, you know, not that one house that might be an available lot somewhere and it's in a residential setting, but you got to think where most of, you got the biggest project that we have on the books now is up by the East Long Meadow border off of North Maple Street. And then all the other housing projects have been south eastern Enfield, where Ken lives. And there's available tobacco land primarily on the eastern half of town. So you're then taking all of this and moving the stuff,
yep,
clear across town. That's right. Where, so it's like, what is that right number? I've heard Suffield's $8,000,
yeah,
as a neighboring town. I don't know what Summers is, but.
Right. Well, it's one of the notes I put down is we'll get the surrounding towns.
Okay. And just one other little piece of that is, so, you know, I totally agree with what Matt said, where there's, right now we're doing the rate setting, where it's really benchmarking time. You could do a cost of service study later and really look at, are we capturing the fees for the different services we're doing? But because we're not even capturing fees now, it's,
right,
you know, it's kind of an incremental thing. So right now to start the process and see where we are, then Kevin will be able to measure what his costs are for these connections, you know, a little more accurately.
And does this fee dictate to a developer what type of housing is built? You know, is it, if it's 3,000, you know, it, does that equate to smaller condominiums? You're getting into the 5,000 to 8,000. Are you talking about 3,000 square foot homes? How big's your house?
1,400.
Well, it probably wouldn't.
I wanted to pick a high number, and I didn't want.
It probably wouldn't determine the size of it, but it could determine the number of units. I mean, that's where it would be hit. So, you know, they may look, instead of doing 100 units, they may only build 50 because of that. I mean, that, but it wouldn't be the size.
I'm on the WPCA in my town, in Simsbury, and we ran into this issue where we have our FCC facility connection charge at $5,600 a year, or per connection. The challenge was someone came with a mixed-use development. We've never seen anything like that in town. We've always had just almost single-family houses, but this was a different proposal, and they were claiming that it's just, they won't use the flow. They won't use the same flow as a normal household with kids and other things because they're smaller units and all. So we actually had to do that cost of service study. We looked at it, we hired an outside consultant, and came back with a lesser percentage. They weren't thrilled, but it was lesser for that, kind of the way the hotels was set up, you know. So you will face these issues in the future.
As a developer, obviously, we wouldn't want to pay any connection fee. But on the flip side, as a developer, I would take a sewer line and pay $5,000 to connect to it over a septic system that's minimum $12,000 plus the amount of land it takes me to have that septic system and the reserve system. So, yes, no developer wants to pay that fee, but if you weigh it out towards a septic system, $5,000 is a bargain, knowing surrounding towns, you know, Suffield is $8,000. So, I mean, Enfield's pretty much maxed out with its sewer systems and stuff like that. Like Scott said, it's pretty far out. So a lot of the development coming to this town isn't going to be hooked to the sewer anyways. It's going to be put on a septic unless people are planning a big sewer expansion, which I don't think is coming to the town. So I really think it's a small percent of what's going to be developed. I agree that $3,000 is low. And, you know, I think it should be average. And I think 5 would be an average number.
Under this sewer connection fee document, where we talk about public unit under the residential, commercial, industrial, does that capture things like hospitals, correctional system additions, nursing homes? How are those dealt with? Assisted living facility.
Great question.
Or should that be under the same category of motels, hotels, and so forth?
It's a good question. It's not addressed.
Okay.
So we'll take a look at that. Thank you.
Tom?
Yeah. Back on the connection fees. I actually think they're pretty reasonable, the $2,000 and $3,000 to start with, $2,000 for residential, $3,000 for business or business hotel. And basically, when you do look at a study like that, we'd have to look at 91 corridor towns. We can't go off to a rural town and try to compare what's their chances, likelihood of getting a hotel in Ellington versus our likelihood of getting a hotel in Enfield versus somebody getting a hotel in Windsor Locks. On 91, close to the airport, we're both in competition for that hotel. So that's the hotel, that's the fee that I want to make sure we're not 5,000 and the neighboring town is only 2,000. And that's why I think for that, we're in a good position as a 91 corridor town. That's what we have to do all our research on, is who we are and what we're going to, you know, be put here. And I'd rather see it on that side, especially with the hotels, because I think we have a good chance of still maybe grabbing one or two. But that's just my take. Thank you.
You're pointing.
Oh, no.
You agree. Okay. Everyone. Okay. Next.
So
So back to billing. Well, I didn't read this one, but I think we addressed it. I don't know if there's any other questions on that. If not, I will move on. So almost done with all this. Obviously, if there's any desire for additional information, they can go to our website. We have set up a special page that on the front page, we'll click on that. We'll go to this. This is going to be covering everything related to the sewer fee change. We'll have the different studies that have been done, as well as a frequently asked question, which we had provided at the last council meeting. If still not too late, if you have any additions you want us to put up there on that, let us know. We are working on a sewer fee estimate calculator that will help residents understand what that impact's going to be. And so obviously the ordinance and all the resolutions, everything related, will go up onto this page.
Tom?
Matt, can we have, and you may have already addressed this and I just missed it, yeah, but can we put something in there for the public that shows some examples of ad valorem past, if you live in a three-bedroom home that's assessed to $200,000, and for the last 15 years, this is what you would have paid a percentage to your taxes. And on the new system, after you look at the calculator, compare the two, and to give somebody that wants to, I'm going to be charged this extra fee, the comparison of what they were paying and how it either works out a little better for them, the same, or a little more expensive based on their usage.
Yeah, we probably could. I've seen some of the betas of the calculator. We might be able, if they input their estimated or what their taxable value is, so it could calculate both what they would have been or what they paid last year. Or probably not what they paid. I mean, would you want what they're paid or what they would be paying if it were ad valorem?
Yeah.
Okay.
We're going to do the upgrades.
Right. So it's because. Yeah. Okay. Yeah, I think we can do something with that on the calculator.
That'll save like 1,000 phone calls. And
yeah.
Make people, like, just by doing that right on that one page, understand
yep.
what it is and
what's
in
it.
Yep.
Thanks.
Cindy.
Thank you. Matt, one other thought here also. Some of the longtime Enfield residents, some of the older people that came in the 60s and the 70s when these older homes were being built, I'm understanding some people are concerned about being charged additional footage, not really understanding what it is we're trying to accomplish. Not getting too wordy on our sheets there on our database, maybe we could have bullets that would, address that concern for the people. It's not based upon a footage, the line, the sewer line footage. There's some confusion there. But not get too wordy, because once you start getting too wordy, then the message gets lost.
So under the FAQ,
I'm sorry?
Something under the frequently asked questions,
yes.
Put that?
Yeah.
Okay.
Yeah, I mean, that might be a thought, because I've already gotten 3 calls on the how much more per foot. And then I'm remembering back in the late 60s, early 70s, when people were, initially tying in, that's what the charge was. And it's a very, honest question. But not to get too wordy, because if you start getting too wordy, people are going to lose the message. Thank you.
Thank you, Cindy. Joey?
I also just want to remind everyone, you no longer, even though it may seem like you're paying a little more, where I think most people may be paying less, but you're no longer going to be paying for your cars and your personal property. So when you figure it, what you would have paid on your car, no longer you're paying. So you're going to get a decrease somewhere else for that sewer fee. And it's really now where being billed where it needs to be billed. And then also, I'd like just to ask Matt a question through Scott, Matt. Can we put out some mailings? It'd be nice to get a couple mailings out, not just one.
Yeah. Well, I think we need to do one main one to all the residents, but I also want to do
detailed one, or you know, kind of a separate to the businesses, because they're going to be affected a little bit differently. So I'm thinking of two that we'll be sending out here in the near future.
Anyone else? Okay. Anything else for this?
Nope, that's my last slide on this, for this.
Okay, so give me a timeline on the website.
That is going up tomorrow. The calculator with the change probably will be a little bit later in the day. I know they, like I said, I've seen the beta. There's a couple issues they still have to work out, but that's going live tomorrow.
And then the rest of these fees are going up there as well?
Yes, that'll be part of everything that we put up there.
So you would, the points where council raised some questions concerning is it the right fee or not?
Right.
Is there clarification that will be on that? These are proposed fees?
Yeah, we'll put the proposed.
Initial draft. Or
yeah. Okay. Yeah, we'll identify that in some way. Yep.
And how are you going to handle, did we reach consensus on the quarters? You know, there was the discussion of the January, February, March, the summer, which would be July, August, September, and can it be flipped back to June to August?
I think I understand what you want to do. I think we need to talk about that to see what the impact is going to be and how to best do it. So
maybe if there's a statement at the top that says, you know, this is based on a proposal.
Right.
Come talk to us on August 5th.
Yeah.
With your suggestions.
Yeah. And that would be what the tag for each one of these are, the proposed, you know, right, amendments, the proposed fee schedule.
Kenny.
Wouldn't that, I understand what you're saying, but I don't think we can dictate which months, because we have to go by the quarter that we're billed by the water company. That's and if everybody's billed a different quarter, one person may get June, July, August, another person may get April, May, June, but it works out they all get 3 months, period. So it should just be simple, the summer 3 months,
your third billing cycle.
Whatever. Because, I mean, Hazardville does it different than Connecticut. I know what you're saying. So we really can't dictate what exact months, because we may not be billed that way. How do we know halfway through a quarter to switch the rate?
Well, you know, one item is that we will be able to get more than just that quarter's data. I mean, we can go back in the previous year and look at you know, what those numbers were. So it could help us, you know, because, again, what we're talking really is an estimation more so than an actual usage number. I have a couple ideas that I think we need to talk it over and how best to achieve that. But I think, you know, when the bill goes out, I think that's what probably this is going to morph to, is that the bill will go out certain quarters or certain times in the quarter, and we may change exactly what the language is for which months that quarter really is being billed for. But I think we just need to talk about that, because I could be here all day going through some of the different estimates.
Quick follow up to that. In our spec to the billing agent, there'll be some consideration in there somewhere for water utilities that estimate a quarter or are unable to read for a quarter.
Yeah.
So that's all part of the typical process?
Yeah.
Okay.
I mean, I think it's again, important to understand that what we're trying to do is, in that 12-month period, that fiscal year, we're trying to derive the revenues necessary. Mm-hmm. And so I think that's, as we look at it, and I think, you know, in the end, you know, you adjust a little bit over here, it's going to adjust something over here. So I don't know necessarily if you know, the time, I mean, it goes back to, you know, how to explain it to the residents. And that's what we're trying to do, is make it as transparent and explainable as possible, so they at least feel that we're not charging them for water that isn't going into the system. But again, the reality is we're trying to raise X amount of dollars, and again, pushing down here pushes up over here.
I agree.
Kenny's still.
And then my last thing would be is there is nothing anywhere that says people who have septic systems are exempt from any sewer fees, such as special assessments. Suppose the sewer authority says we're going to deal with this huge infrastructure problem or situation in Enfield. We're going to put a special assessment on the residents. Mm-hmm. I mean, something in here should say that people who are on septic systems or not connected to the public sewer system are exempt from any and all fees.
And I'm just thinking a couple different scenarios, and you know, one would be, you know, out in the areas we talked about that could be developed, and the town at some point decides, you know, we're going to install sewer. You know, there could be a house there that has its own, you know, septic, but you know, 5 years or 10 years down the road, it fails, and they'll have to connect onto the system.
But then they pay the connection fee.
They should even have to pay a connection fee because they've already paid the taxes
But again, what I'm thinking though is, so this house is built, you know, the day after we go to the away from ad valorem. So they wouldn't have paid for that, you know, that history wouldn't have been there for them paying the taxes into the system. So it'd be a new house onto a septic. Then you do the, because again, I think, you know, we're talking years down the road where that's possible. And so it's possible that a house goes up, you know, after we've converted fully over. So they haven't paid anything through the ad valorem into the system. They have a septic. It fails 10 years after, you know, a sewer line is put in front of them. You know, I think you're going.
I thought you said it after July 2nd or whatever you were going to put in the septic.
Right. I mean, effectively, anything after January 1st.
Right.
But again, we're talking, you know, something that I know right now we're not contemplating any massive sewer expansion in our areas. It's going to be something that's going to be well down the road.
Right, just like we did when we put sewers in Enfield. We ran it in front of the house. There was a sewer lien placed on the sewer, and when you hooked to it, you paid it, or when you sold the property, you paid it. But you were not charged for that until that point.
Right.
And that's what I'm saying. So if that's not in here, we do that big sewer expansion through Carol's neighborhood. All of a sudden, we tell her she's got to pay and got to connect.
Okay.
And that's where I'm saying, if her septic is still operating, why should she have to pay for that,
right,
you know, until she hooks to it? And that's how it was in the past, and I want to make sure it stays that way.
Okay,
you know?
I think I understand what you're saying.
You kind of put a spin on it, but I'm thinking more of the existing households,
right,
that are on a sewer. If we do a special assessment, you know, we should be exempt who have a septic system. I mean, again, we've been paying a sewer tax forever in the town, you know, and, you know, we could end up having to pay a special assessment for sewer pipes that we're not even hooked to.
Right.
And this is more to clarify and correct something that's been wrong for so many years. I'm all set.
Okay.
Thank you.
Anyone else? Okay. So that means we're good for, because we got a second meeting. Just so we're good for the special meeting.
Except you have to pass
the resolution.
Oh, actually,
pass
the resolution.
That's right.
Schedule the public hearing.
And it was read so long ago. All right. So that was the resolution setting the public hearing on August 5th, 2013. At 6:30 p.m. Now, Matt, my question is, now I know a lot of times we set the time based on an assumption of how much time we need.
Right.
Is allocating a half hour sufficient, or do we just make people understand that, yeah, it may start at 6:30, but it will go for as long as it's needed to go for?
Well, and I think that's historically how we've handled those that just go for. I mean, it was kind of difficult to gauge what that turnout's going to be. And typically we do a 6:45 or a 6:50.
Right.
So I did make you know, allowance for that to be a little bit earlier. And then the WPCA has a public hearing for the rates. And that's, I think, is going to be the other issue, is that people coming to speak are probably more going to be speaking about the rate piece. So it's going to be kind of difficult to differentiate, you know, the public comments coming in. So we're going to have to be cognizant of that as well.
Okay.
But
yeah. And you're going to have a presentation that's pretty streamlined but informative.
Oh, yes. Much more streamlined.
Okay. So we have the resolution. I know it was motioned and seconded. Any further discussion on the motion? Then, sensing none, roll call, please.
Councilman Arnone.
Four.
Councilman Bosco.
Four.
Councilman Crowley.
Four.
Councilman Hall.
Four.
Mayor Copeland.
Four.
Councilman Kinsler.
Four.
Councilman Lee.
Four.
Councilman Mangini.
Four.
Deputy Mayor Nelson.
Four.
Councilman Stokes.
Four.
Yes, 10 in favor, none against, no abstentions.
And do we have a motion to adjourn the special meeting?
So moved.
Second.
By Ken, seconded by Tom Kinsler. All those in favor? Those opposed? We are adjourned from our special meeting, and we move right into the Water Pollution Control Authority meeting with roll call, please.
Commissioner Arnone. Commissioner Bosco.
Here.
Commissioner Crowley.
Here.
Commissioner Edgar. Commissioner Hall.
Here.
Chairman Copen.
Here.
Commissioner Kinsler.
Here.
Commissioner Lee.
Here.
Commissioner Mangini.
Here.
Vice Chairman Nelson.
Here.
Commissioner Stokes.
Here.
There are 9 members present, 2 are absent.
Minutes of the preceding meeting, regular meeting, June 3rd, 2013.
So moved.
By Commissioner Nelson, seconded by Commissioner Mangini. Discussion? Sensing none, show of hands, all those in favor. Those opposed, any abstentions? One abstention. Commissioner Bosco? Commissioner? The commish. All right. Next item, discussion resolution setting a public hearing to adopt new sewer rates and fees effective January 1st, 2014. Whereas the Enfield Town Council is adopting amendments to Chapter 86 Utilities, which requires the Enfield Water Pollution Control Authority to adopt a sewer fee schedule. And whereas the amendments require a public hearing to be held prior to the Enfield Water Pollution Control Authority adopting the sewer fee schedule. Now, therefore, be it resolved that the Enfield Water Pollution Control Authority does hereby schedule a public hearing to be held on August 5th, 2013 at 6:50 p.m. in the Enfield Town Hall Council Chambers, 820 Enfield Street, Enfield, Connecticut, in order to allow interested citizens an opportunity to express their opinions regarding the proposed sewer fee schedule.
So moved. Second.
By Commissioner Hall, seconded by Commissioner, we'll give it to the girls, Commissioner Mangini. Discussion. So this would be, that's the fee document that we've already discussed. Any further discussion, commissioners? None. Roll call, please.
Commissioner Arnone.
Four.
Commissioner Bosco.
Four.
Commissioner Crowley.
Four.
Commissioner Hall.
Four.
Chairman Copen.
Four.
Commissioner Kinsler.
Four.
Commissioner Lee.
Four.
Commissioner Mangini.
Four.
Vice Chairman Nelson.
Four.
Commissioner Stokes.
Four.
10 in favor, none against, and no abstention.
Any other items in front of the Water Pollution Control Authority? Sensing none, is there a motion to adjourn by Vice Chair Nelson, seconded by Commissioner Mangini? All those in favor? Those opposed? We are adjourned. Good evening.